You know, thanks for tuning in to another episode of Mindset Check. We have Danielle Short on the show today. Danielle, thanks for being on.
Thanks for inviting me, David.
Our conversation offline is always great, and I really wanted to capture some of that, you know, that conversation on our podcast and then in this specific platform. The title is Why Resourcefulness is the Key to Unlocking Your Potential. Like, you have just this great energy about you, confident yet very approachable, and I love to dive in and kind of see how you were able to create that for yourself, because that's not always the case for people. Even if, you know, you're successful, some people tend to even shy away a little bit, but you have this very like I said, very you're able to connect with people, build rapport, but you have this very centered and confident way about yourself. And so I just wanted to dive into that with you and see where that all started and kind of how you navigate the day. I've dealt with this, and you know, you can share as much as you want, but inner critic, right? We all have that inner critic that comes up, right? And starts to potentially, you know, distract you from achieving your dreams, from becoming self-actualized and becoming more of who you're meant to be, right? So do you have an inner critic?
Of course I do. Yes.
And what do you do? Like, if how do you silence it? And how do you, you know, if you could share kind of how you navigate that? Because that, I think that's one of our biggest obstacles.
I don't feed it. I don't give it attention. I'm aware of it. I know it's there. It pops up. And I don't engage. I don't try to get rid of it, because that would be ridiculous.
Sure.
Sometimes it's important to have a critic. And times I need that. But when I don't need it, and it's coming up trying to run the show, I'm aware of that, and I just simply ignore it.
When do you know it's something you need to kind of allow?
Because I know when it's not, because it doesn't align with my goals. So I know that it's not something that I need to be paying attention to, because it's not in sync with the direction that I've decided to go. When it's important to have the inner critic is when I need to really pursue some different viewpoints about things. So maybe I'm questioning something, or maybe I'm not 100% certain to proceed in a certain fashion. So at that point, I like to be able to look at both sides of the situation. So sure. It does have value. Mm. I don't see it as a bad thing. I just know its place.
Oh, wow. That's powerful. Yeah. So you use it as something to help build you up, to help you get you closer to your goals. But you don't allow it to be the voice in your head, the dominating voice in your head that's steering you throughout the day.
Exactly. Like you said, I don't let it run the show. It wasn't always that way for me. I have worked on myself and self-improvement and being the best that I can be the majority of my life. Mm-hmm. And I mean, I've been working, I think I'd shared this with you before, I work with a life coach. Actually, my husband is a life coach.
I know that. That's great.
Yes. So much of our life revolves around how do we redirect our life to go in the direction that we choose? Mm-hmm. How do we make the most empowering decisions, the actions that are going to create win-wins for everyone that's involved? I mean, this is just a normal way of living mm-hmm. for me. But years and years ago, I wasn't aware of these things. So I think it's a process. It's something that just like anything that you get good at, it's just practice.
Was there ever a voice? Was there ever like a whisper like, hey, Danielle, you know, like you're meant for more, or keep going? Or was there any positive voice in your inner world?
Oh, definitely. It's driven me. Mm-hmm. It's driven me to reach for the things that I want and the success that I've experienced. But first and foremost, I think you have to start from a place of deciding what do you want? Mm-hmm. Who do I want to be? Who do I want to be? That to me is the most important question. Who do I want to be? Who do I want to be as a person? Who do I want to be as a wife? Who do I want to be as a mom, as a sister, as a real estate agent, as a grandmother? I have grandchildren, who do I want to be? How do I want to show up in the world?
As a fur baby mama, right? Because you have a new baby.
I do have a little 5-month-old puppy, Willa. She's adorable.
Oh, that's awesome.
There's a full amount of self-reflection, because I believe in the principle of be, do, have. Mm. You have to be something first before you start the doingness to have it. So I had to see myself as and see myself as a successful real estate agent.
Sure.
I had to create that idea of myself. Then I start the doingness of what does a successful real estate do? So then I start doing stuff.
Right.
You know, promoting myself, communicating, talking to people, whatever that is, whatever that works for me. And then I have the experience.
Yeah, because then once your identity is clear, then your actions, naturally your brain's going to start working and your actions are going to match your identity, right?
That's right.
So question, and this might be something we can go into another time, but just your sense of direction, like, you know, you said you steer your life in the direction you want to go. And obviously that goes back with having clarity of who you are, right? But is there like a balance? Is there a greater entity or a greater being that has a destiny for you? Or do you believe it's kind of something you co-create? Or is it something that you figure out? Or is it something you solely create on your own?
We could spend a long time talking about that. A really long time.
Right. Well, so here, the reason I ask is I grew up, I grew up in a very conservative environment. Not that that's bad, but just so I had a lot of a religious background. Both my grandparents, both my granddads were pastors. And so, you know, heavy church, and not that that's bad. It's just, I feel like my beliefs are different than, let's say, probably some of the beliefs that my parents hold. And for me, I feel like God is guiding, but yet also allowing, right, for us to make choices and decisions. I'm always curious, like, what do other people believe? Because everybody has a different upbringing, a different environment.
Sure.
Like,
we are all a part of God.
Mm.
All of us.
Mm-hmm.
We are all a part of that God, awareness, spirit, infinite, whatever you want to call it.
Mm-hmm.
It's all a part of us.
Mm-hmm.
Everyone sees it, maybe sees it a little bit different.
Sure.
To me, everything is connected to that. Everything I do is connected to a greater awareness. I think part of the self journey is learning how to differentiate between you as the one that is aware. I'm not saying that I have the awareness of God. I don't.
Sure.
But I have the awareness of knowing who I am.
Mm-hmm.
I know who I am.
Yes.
I'm not confused in a myriad of identities that are caught up in a lot of drama or lower kind of vibrational things. I'm not going to say that doesn't come up for me, because it does. And I work on my stuff every day. The thing about being connected, absolutely. We are all connected. Some are more aware of it than others.
Yeah, totally. I will say that I feel like there's always been something pulling me towards awareness, right? Like changing habits and being able to become more aware. And like you said, like kind of operate from that awareness and operate from mm-hmm. that higher consciousness,
yes.
so to speak, and not identify with even the, you know, the lower level vibrational things, events, people, activities, thoughts,
well,
you know
where they're going to take you. And so I have to ask myself, am I done learning everything I need to learn from that experience? I mean, why are we here anyway? Why are we even here in this life? We're here to learn.
Mm.
We're here to gain experience. We're here to learn how to be a human being. So how much more do I need to learn going through these negative experiences? I have to decide. I'm not done yet, or am I done? Have I learned everything there is to learn about going through whatever it is, the drama, the pain, the blame, the the victimization, you know, or do I still need to explore that some more?
Well, you empower yourself if you have that, if you feel,
yes.
if you feel like I get to decide that, because
that's
otherwise
right.
You just kind of relinquish your power. And you're just like, well, where does that leave you? Because no one's going to come save you.
It's up to you. So if I don't decide knowingly, then what's going to happen is I'm going to fall into a default.
Mm-hmm.
And what have my defaults been in the past?
Based on your programming, right? Based on your patterns.
Exactly. That's exactly right. One of the things you had asked me about was kind of like, what do you do every day? What do I do every day to
yes.
start my day? Where do I begin? First of all, I'm cognizant of the day and what can I make of this day? And that's on one level. On another level, it's very analytical for me. I'm a list maker. I need to do this. I need to call this person. I need to handle this. I need to go to this appointment. So I have a very organized, logical format that I follow. But in addition, I'm open to the flow of what life is going to bring for that day. Mm-hmm. As far as bringing all that into the concept in real estate, for me, real estate is just a continuous flow. I've been very fortunate. My business is consistent, but that's the way I see it. I see it as consistent.
Well, and you're consistent, right? And mm-hmm. so that's where it's a reflection of you, like everything. I see a lot of entrepreneurs, agents, you know, even myself included. I know when I have a really good month, it's because it's reflecting my inner world, how I'm setting myself up for the day, how I'm executing first mentally, visually, and then like you said, identifying with that, and then my actions will mirror my identity, my values, and so on.
That's right. Yeah, that's exactly right. What I've seen happen, and actually this just happened recently, I was having a little conversation with my manager about this. The market has been unprecedented busy mm-hmm. and kind of crazy and in my mind very unhealthy. But for agents, you know, it's just been boomtown, right?
Yes.
It's just boomtown.
Gold rush.
Well, now what's happening, and I've said this all along, eventually it will flatten. Mm-hmm. It'll stop. So now what's happening is we're starting to see that pull back a little bit. Mm-hmm. Which I fully expected to happen. And I'm prepared for it.
Right.
But there are other top producing agents that are a little bit freaked out now. It's like, oh my gosh, what do I do? Here's the answer. First of all, the inner critic is wanting you to focus on panic and lack. No, that's not happening. You focus on abundance. You focus that things are still selling and that my business is good or whatever. Whatever language works for you, and don't get caught up in that energy of worry and fear and panic and lack and, you know, what am I going to do now? You just keep doing the same thing you've always done.
You know, when you're in the emotion of worry and scarcity, I've been there, right? I think all mm-hmm. of us have been there at some point.
I have too.
So we feel it. And like you said, the inner critic, similar to that, you understand it's there, it's an emotion. Mm-hmm. But then it's what I've been learning to do recently is like visually, the way I see it visually, it's hard to explain, but the way I see it is I'm operating on this lower level and now I have to allow it, but then move my thinking up to a higher awareness where I can then observe myself, what I'm going through, the emotions I'm experiencing, and realize that isn't me. That isn't my reality. That is just something that's passing by, right?
That's right.
And if I can allow myself to do that, then I have a better chance at responding, not reacting, but responding to my situation.
Exactly right. That's exactly right, David. What I have found for me, you know, falsehood cannot survive in truth. So if I'm in the middle of some emotion that is, say it's fear mm-hmm. or lack or panic or whatever it is, or anxiety, what I have, and I can feel it, I mm-hmm. feel it on my body. Mm-hmm. It's not just a mental idea. You feel it going on the body. So what I've found that helps is I label it for exactly what it is. This is anxiety. And this is what it feels like on my body. This is it. Now, by doing that, for me at least, what it does is it kind of pops me out of it and goes, oh, that's what that is.
And then it allows you to get out of it, I think. Cause like,
exactly.
Sometimes when you identify too much with the emotion, then you're left there. You can't escape it.
You know, what's that old saying about just a degree of separation? It's mm-hmm. just, you know, you just need that one degree of separation where you can see it for what it is so that you're observing it, you're not listening to it.
Yes.
Like you said, observing it.
Yeah. Well, and it sounds like you have a really good handle on that. And obviously you have the human element in your experience. So you're going to have those moments. but at least you get better at it, right? At least the time from when you feel it to the time that you overcome it is shortened over time.
Yes.
Right?
And it's, you know, it's like I said earlier, it's just practice. Right. And I'll tell you about life is very good at giving lots of opportunities for practice.
Yes.
Until eventually it's just an automatic thing. You see it and you go, no, I know what that is.
Right.
I've decided not to go down that road. That doesn't align with who I am. So I'm not going down there.
Yes. 100%. Then you start to realize it and then you can pivot get to where you want to go faster, internally as well. Right. Because again, then
yes.
The internal world, your inner world reflects is going to be reflected in your outer world.
100%. The objective is the physical world and the subjective is what's going on in your head. And everything in the objective is created subjectively.
That's powerful. That's powerful. Yeah. And then, you know, that just gives you an empowering position to be like, okay, I can choose my mm-hmm. inner world. I mean, I've been there where you're just kind of like, I don't feel like I can ever escape this emotion. And so I love talking about it because then I feel like others who are listening, who may be experiencing it can also elevate above that emotion and feeling.
Yeah.
And then, you know, like you said, steer yourself in a different direction. As of right now, what's a theme in your life, or what's kind of an overarching kind of value that you hold that's kind of your rock as you go into your week, as you go into a presentation, as you go into anything that causes you to maybe like get nervous a little bit or feel some of the negative emotions, but then you pull yourself back because you remember, you know, something.
Gratitude. Remaining in a state of gratitude for whatever comes up. Being grateful for the experience. What can I learn from this? How is this helping me grow as a person? What does this reveal about me? Being grateful for everything. I think that, you know, I think most people have been through hard times in their life. They've gone through difficult situations. I certainly have. And sometimes when you're at your lowest low, the only thing that you can do to get out is to just accept it and then move from acceptance to a place of gratitude. So every day I intentionally decide that I'm grateful. And at night when I go to bed at night, I say it. I thank you. Thank mm-hmm. you for the life I have. Thank you for the wonderful things I have in my life. And thank you for the situations that are going on that might not seem so wonderful, because I know I'm going to get through it. I'm going to learn a valuable lesson. And it's just evolving me as a person to a better place.
Right.
So I would say the theme, the value, the way that I've decided to approach life is through, as I said, an attitude of gratefulness. And it sounds simple, but does it have to be complicated?
Right. Absolutely. I mean, that's such a valid question, right? Like, well, why do we have to complicate it? I mean, it's
yeah.
beautiful how you articulated that. It's basically getting to a place of a point of neutrality and like, okay, this is happening. Mm-hmm. You don't have to hate it. You don't have to love it, but just get to a place where you're neutral about it. Like you've accepted it. And
yes.
then at that point, it's almost like you let the barriers down and then you move yourself towards gratitude. And that's
yeah.
beautiful. I mean, how could you not, move towards a state of bliss when you're in gratitude? Well, Danielle, thank you so much. That was so impactful. For me, it was so edifying. I appreciate you. Thank you for sharing your wisdom and your knowledge and being vulnerable. And I appreciate you. And I hope to have you back on here again. Thank you for spending some time with me today.
I would love to. I'd love to.
Perfect.
It's a pleasure.
All right.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, Danielle. Have a good
day.
All right.
You do the same. Bye.
Bye.